Hi, Katrina.
How are you?
I'm extremely good. Very happy and excited.
Everything looking wonderful?
Yes.
Excellent. Emma, this extraordinary drawing, which is part of the Kicking Off series, I mean, this sense of movement, the tension in the musculature, it's truly outstanding. But when you create a piece like this, how do you approach it? What is it you're trying to achieve?
Well, the thing is, I have been interested ever since I started drawing in musculature and in movement.
Yeah.
And I think this drawing is the first of several drawings you'll see today that have tried to definitely capture that. And the other thing is, I really wanted to capture it in a way that was completely fresh and innovative.
Yeah.
And that is generally how I approach my drawings. Katrina, the thing is, that's also great about this is you've got these wonderful sort of energy lines from the neck coming powering down to the sort of powerfulness on the front feet and the sort of full stop of the back legs and the swishing tail, which I think is something I have certainly seen in horses, and I think I have managed to convey well. Yeah, I think I've captured it. It's also about, for me, conveying the mystery, the excitement, the beauty.
This is Émile Faure, isn't it?
It's Émile Faure, yes, the dressage rider. This, for me, is an interesting painting because as a painter, you kind of start and you have an idea in your head. And often, by the time you've finished a particular piece of work, you've had such a tussle with the surface, because it's saying, no, I don't want to go there. And you're saying, yes, I do want you to go there. But in fact, this painting I saw in my head, and it is almost verbatim what I saw as the original idea. So in a sense, it was a dream painting to do,
yeah,
because it didn't give me
size. Any
trouble. Size is imperative.
Yeah.
That would look well stupid, really stupid, if it was this big.
Yeah.
And it conveys the drama, and I love the drama, I love the theatre of it.
Yeah,
and if I'm doing portraits with horses, it's something I'd like to extend. I mean, one day I'd love to do children, more horses. I mean, you can really extend the idea, and I'm really looking forward to that opportunity.
This is Ruban, isn't it?
Yes, yes it is. And the reason I did that was I felt while I am doing these innovative pieces, I thought it was very important to be able to convey to the onlooker that I can also do the traditional
sure.
thing. Also, get a great deal of pleasure out of it. I mean, you know, having to evoke that wonderful coat gives me immense pleasure. So
yeah.
That's why I did that. So that, you know, it shows the total sort of arena of what I'm capable of doing. The thing is, if you're going to make a drawing this big, by virtue of the fact that your material, a lead pencil, is so tiny, it is going to slow you down. You know, if you're working on a painting, you can take a very broad brush and you can succeed in doing what takes almost a week on that. You can do in like two or three swipes, which will take you, I don't know, 20 minutes or something. Well, less, but once it's all knitted together, probably more. But I think what I find interesting about this is that because I was forced to slow down, it gives it a kind of weight, because you're aware that the person has worked, i.e. me, has worked on these really in great, great detail and with great thought, and I would like to think love. And I think it's a wonderful, it's sort of contained energy as a consequence. You're kind of aware of the weight of it.
And an additional dimension.
Yes, well, I think because it takes so long, then by almost out of nowhere, it's kind of the mystery of drawing, really, or painting, something else has become infused in it. And for me, the only way I can describe that is suddenly on this two-dimensional surface, you've got the fourth dimension appearing, which I would say was time.
Yeah.
And I think that manifests itself in that.
This particular work has such an extraordinary sense of tension.
Yes.
And I mean, I think it, the energy just leaps off the paper.
Katrina, one of the things that has fascinated me for a lifetime, since I was teeny weeny, is the whole idea of tension. And it doesn't just appear in drawings for me, it appears in ballet, it appears in boxing.
Sure.
You've got these things coming together, you've got them going apart. And again, there's an energy there. There's an energy for and against, for and against. And of course, the minute that you have tension, you've got engaging of muscles.
And again,
you've got pulling, pushing.
The sense of movement again.
Yeah.
Which is all incorporated in the work.
To me, these beasts are like, in many ways, my eyes kind of do a thing where I sort of see them almost as ballet dancers.
Yeah.
I can't really explain it. You know, the thing is, if I was a writer, I could write it down, but the fact is these are drawings and these are paintings, and ultimately they have to speak for themselves.
Did you do a painting of Nuria for many years ago?
Yes, I did.
Maybe this is all these
I'm crazy for it. And actually, it's, you know, it's that thing of wanting initially, decades ago, to go into a ballet studio, wasn't allowed to, so ended up in boxing gyms instead. But, you know, for me, again, it was just watching the tension.
Yeah,
you know?
Superb.
And I love all that.
Superb.
And the energy that is just comes through all that.
And these are a wonderful size.
Size is very important. To me, it was imperative that these were these sizes. And indeed, it was also imperative that they weren't sketches.
You know, absolutely.
I could have done that like a sketch. I could have gone rather thoughtlessly. But I wanted a density. I wanted a kind of contradiction here of having something amazingly well worked, and yet it was something really quite frisky. That's the general idea of that. Resize, I think I'd like to show you some other works about this to kind of illustrate that rather better. Here we've got a painting which is actually small. Now, I find this painting really quite interesting because actually it could have been painted large.
Right.
But most paintings dictate precisely what size they want to be. Actually, I think that works as a little painting. However, interestingly, that's probably the only image in the whole room that you could bust it up to 10 foot. And it would still work.
Yeah.
The only other problem you have of busting things up to be much, much bigger is you dilute the detail.
Yeah.
So you have to be very careful. You'd have to have a very interesting subject like that one, which is very busy, to get away with making it much bigger.
This is the 2011 Guineas, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
It is.
And this is just quite close to when they've just...
When they started, and it's that heavenly new market landscape, which I adore.
Yes.
I'm just crazy for the skies up there, because they're sort of different to other skies I've ever seen. They haven't got little puffy clouds. They've either got an atmospheric background, or they've got these wonderful low-lying clouds, like in Ruban. And actually, and this is a very good example, because very difficult to frame. I love doing all these little bits in here, you know, all this detail, you know. It took a lot of time, but I think the overall effect was completely worth it. That's what I call a heroic piece. It's a statuesque piece. And the reason I did that, there are some people, you know, who do have the wall space and actually would like a sort of whopping great thing. Funnily enough, actually, one of the things I was thinking about, there's a whole bunch of Mexican painters, Quiros, Orozco, Riviera, who used to do massive sort of heroic paintings, political, I know, as indeed the Russians did massive political bits of work. But I like the idea of that sort of, it just overwhelms you, whereas when you're on a little one, it draws you in, whereas you get more overwhelmed, and it produces different psychological feelings within the viewer. The reason I like this is a sort of time immemorial image, because this is pre-race. And again, you've got a different sort of energy, a different thing going on here, because what you've got actually is the jockey containing the horse. This horse, I mean, this horse has been trained for this moment. So you've got this really keyed up, fit highly strung, well-bred animal on its toes, waiting to rip. And I loved the idea of watching the jockeys just wheeling their horses around, trying to keep them under control. Gina, I'd like to be able to show you how and why Newmarket is a gift compositionally. You see, you've got this big skyline, and you've got this animal. Now, for me, it was imperative these ears broke up that skyline as well as him. Now, imagine if the ears had been slightly down, something would have been lost there. And if the head had gone too high, I think it would have also destroyed the balance of the picture. So it was, I just think that works very well. The other thing is, because the background is so far away, you can make it slightly fuzzier with the paint. You can paint it in a more impressionist way. And then you can bring into much greater focus your foreground. And I think then the energy actually gets concentrated and the looker's eye gets concentrated at the front. And I think the background acts as a nice foil. To show all aspects of your work, and I think it's important as an artist to engage your imagination.
This is Tashold yearling.
It was just a yearling. I mean, all I wanted to do was I really wanted to have a go at making this rather sort of dreamy background, atmospheric background. And also playing with that colour, and it took a long time for me to work out precisely which colour should it be, a green grey, should it be a blue grey, and I think it complements very nicely the coat of the horse. I've thought about this quite carefully, and coming from a family of writers, I mean, you know, I've been told consistently, you know, you have to take, there aren't that many subjects. And if you're a writer, you're going back almost to the Bible or somewhere like that. There's betrayal, love, injustice, that kind of thing. And you have to take an old subject and you have to put a new spin on it. And actually putting the whole figure in. So you've got a huge drawing of somebody's horse specifically tailored for them.
Yeah, it would be exquisite.
Look fantastic.
The detail is absolutely incredible. And Emma, this painting here, Oil on Canvas,
well, the reason I did that was because you've seen an example in lead, you've seen an example in crayon. You know, I love painting portrait heads as well.
Sure.
I hope it, again, you know, I wanted to put it against a jet black background because I think it just gives it, again, a slightly modern twist.
Yeah.
But, you know, all these mediums I adore using and, so I wanted to just give the full range of...
Sure, absolutely. And finally, but last but by absolutely no means least, we have the last two drawings.
Yes, and the reason I did those was because, well, the whole animal is beautiful, or the whole head, I just think occasionally it's nice just to focus in on one tiny aspect of the horse. What can I say about that? I just think it's such a brilliant movement, and yet I think with the pencil and the way it's been portrayed, I think it's also rather beautiful. It sort of becomes an object in its own right.
Yeah.
And that, I didn't just want to do a straight head, I wanted to try and throw a different slant on it so the viewer is compelled or propelled to sort of see it in a slightly different way.
And there's great detailing on the veins and the anatomy of the actual the head.
My favourite.
Emma Kenaway, thank you very much indeed, and congratulations.
It's a pleasure.